somewhere else. It's too short for this one. I was very fond of it. I could use this one. No, I couldn't. I made it too
short. Oh, yeah, that's what I was thinking, too.
Yeah.
Oh.
So here I am. I'm going to test them to make sure they're strong enough to put some pressure on. And then I'm just going to work between my crazy limbs. And that means that the warp will be all different lengths. That's what I'm doing. And then I'm going to weave, as I did on that one, just random elements. Where is that beautiful limb that you brought? She picked the perfect limb for you.
Christine, you look Judith. I almost went in the river getting it. We have to appreciate.
Oh my God!
Feathers. What happened? When you get bugs,
you get bugs
on anything. You won't get. You won't get more bugs on here than if you use wool.
But if you do feathers and tapestry, how do you not get?
So you will love
this. They're the same bugs you're going to get on wool.
Exactly. Because I think a woman bought some yarn for me, and I said, if you get bugs, it's your own.
Yeah. No, bugs come. You have to just be diligent. A freezer will help. What will really work best, though, is using dry ice. Because the freezer will often stimulate the eggs to hatch. Mm-hmm. And it's the eggs you have to get rid of, not just the
crawly
things. Yeah.
So,
yeah. Oh, sorry, I'm just not going to stab
you. Bringing that home with
you? No, that's okay.
Okay, now look at this one. We could put this in.
Just put this in the trunk.
It's strong enough.
Yeah.
And we'll break it there. We can break it down here and weave around that moss.
Oh.
Leave that moss as if it was that mohair. It will be very interesting. It'll last forever. Now and then you could spray it now and then. And
a little mist.
Yeah, a little mist. But flip it up there. And when you warp it, you can flip it back down when you've woven your material. And it would be quite fetching in that 1960s way. And believe me, not that we should care about trends. This is, we should do what we like best. But it's very trendy right now to weave in the 1960 very free-form tapestry. And on a free-form tapestry, we can do all sorts of things with that warp. We can divide the warp and wrap it, with bright yarns and beads and all sorts of things, and then divide it back up. So all the warp's going to be on this one is little warp strip.
Some on the floor right there.
Right here was a whole lot.
Okay, here I picked out, but I'm the one that messed up. My thrifty nature.
Is there that period in the 60s, is it called anything for the weaving besides
the 60s?
No, we just say 60s.
Those of us who lived through the 60s don't need to know anything else.
No, it was very wild and creative, and we wove with everything. I worked with a woman, her name was Eileen I always call her Holman because I know Eileen Holman too, but Eileen, can't remember her last name. She made one half of a cover for a skyscraper out of videotape. She also crocheted videotape to cover her Volkswagen. And I mean, that's what people were doing. It was like
the age of Aquarius.
It was the age of
Aquarius. It was
outside the box.
Well, it was good for us. It made us better weavers in the end. We thought differently. What we did was we threw out tradition with vast abandon.
Mm-hmm.
And then later came to our senses and said, okay, that was fun. My tapestry that is hanging on that wall has lasted 3 years and it's starting to look a little drecky. And I know the Medici's tapestries lasted for, a thousand years. So what went wrong here? And then we went back and said, when do we need to have tradition? And that's mainly, I would say that's what America, the U.S., does best. You threw everything out and said, let's start fresh. And you did, and there's wonderful things that come from that. It is sometimes more work, more effort. You have to work harder at it. But guess what? In the end, you have a fresh idea, and you have a new way of looking at things. It's not a bad thing to throw out tradition now and then. just remember where you put it.
It's coming back again.
Because you are going to need it, you know, one of these days. So on this loom, this bar is meant to go under here, and I'm going to tack it on with my warp. I'm going to pull my warp up here, and I'm just going to put my warp strings. I'm just going to do a continuous warp like we did. No fancy stuff. It has pegs here that you can move up to shorten it and lower it. I wish that they were a little closer together so we could use them as a tension device, but they are. But it's a nice little loom, and the guy, if you want to know who made it, it's a guy back east, and
his name's on that back bar.
Yeah, I think it's on the back bar. I don't know where his contact stuff is, but it's very nice. It was $200. You can make one yourself pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. I know you can. But if you didn't feel like it, you felt like doing that, yeah. Sweet little loom.
Stephen Willett.
Yeah.
Willette.
Willette.
Willette. Willette.
So was your wolf weaving
spinning?
Yeah. Didn't you do some weaving with that?
I did. I wove that warp and weft for blankets and sold it. Yeah.
Those must have been yummy.
Oh, yeah, they still are. They're wonderful and they last really well. They look like soap bubbles, but they're very, very structural and sound.
But that, so that's